students. In this video, we are going to see the last part of these eco-friendly technologies, that is environmental impact assessment. See, when you go for a driving class, when you want to ride a bike, what do you need? You need a license, right? So what do they do? You would go there and you would go to the RTO. You would have to ride and show it to him. He assesses how you are riding, how you are going to turn left. Are you going to put the indicator? Are you going to turn right or left or whatever it is? He assesses you before he gives you the clearance. Yes, you are fit to ride on the road. Right? Same thing happens with driving. So there is an assessment that happens. Similarly, there is an assessment that is required for the environment too, because we need to save the environment. We need to conserve the resources. How do you do that? So whenever there is a human activity or whenever there is a project that's coming up in a big scale or a large scale, what happens? Before doing that, we have to go for this clearance, that is environmental impact assessment. This is of two types. Initially, there is a preliminary assessment. Okay, so the people come to you when you go and submit your project, they would analyze it and see whether a detailed assessment is required for your project or not. Probably it's a very small one, then they just ignore it. It's not needed. Then if it is going to be on a larger scale, then we need to go into this environmental impact assessment. What is this about? See, this is actually to identify and to predict what are the impacts that these can give. If you are starting a human activity, what is its impact on human health? For example, if you have a thermal power plant near your house, imagine a lot of smoke is coming out. The atmosphere is heated up and there's a lot of fly ash. So it is affecting your health, right? So what does it have on the health? What does it have do on the environment? That's part of the assessment. And not only that, it is also to facilitate sustainable development. How do you sustain the resources without getting affected? How do you sustain the resources? The third one, you can maximize the environmental effects, that is the beneficial ones. For example, see, if you are setting up a huge factory, what could you do? You could encourage them or motivate them to plant a large number of trees around. So the green belt increases and there's some rainwater harvesting. So you are maximizing the environmental effects. Then you also have the most important one is methods to develop least cost options. See, everything and anything needs money. It's all rounding up into, or it's going corner to the financial status of yourself, right? If you are going to start a project, you need to first know how much of finance you can invest on, right? So that is where the least cost options come into effect. Okay, we must see that the project is successful. At the same time, the cost should be at the lowest. Okay, it must be a least cost option. So what are those cost options? If we see there are different steps for this environmental impact assessment. Okay, so coming down to the first step, start with screening. When we do screening, whether a detailed assessment is required or whether this is actually causing some impact, or we can give the clearance straight away. So that is about the screening. When you come to scoping, this is to see whether the impacts that are being caused by this, like the key issues, if there are any key issues that would cause some impact and on the environment. So that is about scoping. The third step, we go to the impact analysis. From the word, you can say, what are the impacts that are caused? What are the impacts it could cause? All these can be caused. See the impacts that it could be having on the ecosystem. It could affect the land, okay? It could affect the forest. If it's a huge thing that for which a place in a forest area is selected, what would they do if a building has to come up? They would definitely clear off a lot of trees, okay? Large number of trees would be gone. So that's about the forest or the aquatic system. How? Supposing they have it somewhere near the shore, maybe near the bank of a river or in the seashore, what happens? All the waste is just getting into the river or the water. So aquatic ecosystem is affected. Then when you come to the earth, see, the soil is affected. Water is affected. Water gets polluted. Air is affected. If it's going to have a large chimney and a lot of smoke is coming out, lot of oxides of sulfur and nitrogen and carbon dioxide, all these gases are coming out, then the air is contaminated. Ultimately, when air and water and soil are contaminated, there will be huge climatic changes that will be happening. The earth gets warmed up, global warming comes up, right? Then you have, on the social impact, you have man. Okay, when all these things are affected, it automatically comes down, zeroes down on man's health, man's good being, well-being, okay, livelihood, everything gets affected by this assessment. When we see this, if the impacts, the negative impacts, then the landscape. Okay, if the landscape is good, see, if you're going to live in a fresh a place, a clean place, it definitely matters. Or if you're going to live in a very crowded area, in a polluted area, it definitely matters. So the lifespan, your health, your well-being depends on the landscape. So all these are the impact analysis that we come across. Then we go to mitigation. See, after all these analysis, supposing we see that a lot of waste, the project says that the lot of waste will be just gone into or will be washed into the river nearby. What is the danger there? The river ecosystem, the living organisms, the fish, everything can be affected near the river. Understood? So what happens? We give them alternate plans. So that is mitigation. So what happens, the environmental assessment team, they would suggest alternate plans, alternate sites. Okay, so why not do it like this? Why not do it like this? Why can't you have a waste treatment plant? So all these are alternate suggestions that are given. That's called as that. That's what mitigation is about. And after that is the final report and review. So when it comes to mitigation, when you say alternate plans, not only that, when you go into these things, the cost also is considered. Okay, it is also cutting down the, not only cutting down the waste, not only cutting down the chemicals which are responsible for polluting and contamination, it also is something to do with cut down of money. Okay, so you're cutting down the cost. That also is a very important part of this step called mitigation. Okay, then we come finally to the report and review. So they say, okay, we can clear it. Provided post this, after this, when the project is set up, even after that, post monitoring is very important. Okay, so we would continue to monitor whether you are sticking by the alternate plans, alternate sites, and the treatment for all the waste so that it is not going to cause any harm to the environment. That is what is about cutting down the cost options. So these are the options that we can think of to develop in a project, so that even afterwards, if this project is set up, now we have an idea, so we can still come up with later when projects are coming up, we could think of all these options. So you could just pop these things, no? These are the important things that you have to have in mind whenever you are setting up a project. So that is what this EIA is about. Okay, now we will move on to the advantages and the disadvantages of EIA. Advantages are that, see, it is including the cooperation of the local people. So when you give or you propose a project, it goes to the awareness. So these people have to give a review. Okay, so is it going to affect us? Is it going to be bothersome to us? Is it going to affect our health? So all these things would be done by the local people. So when you do it with the consent of the local people, we are going to get the cooperation of them. You're going to get the support of them. So it becomes much, much easier than to have some unpleasantness there between. Okay, and also when we go, it can also give you, you can reduce the cost. So as we saw saw in mitigation, as we saw in the impact analysis, what can happen? You can bring down cost to a certain extent, to a great extent, in fact, also with all the alternate plans that are available, okay? But there are some disadvantages too. It's very time consuming, okay? See, it involves not only this, there are actually about nearly 8 steps in this environmental impact assessment. So when you go in detail, each step takes its own time. So it takes a lot of time. So before the project begins, this itself will be taking a lot of time. Then the cost is also high. Why is the cost high for an assessment? Because, see, you need people who are really qualified, who would go into that place and then assess with the help of the local community. So it's not going to be, it's a matter of time. It's also a matter of people, the skilled or qualified people, and they are very, very less. So these are the disadvantages of EIA. Scope of grassroot upward planning versus trickle down theory. There are two types, okay? One is you start from the grassroot and you just come up. That's the one theory. The other one is from the higher level, you just bring it down. So these are the two things, okay? When you come to the grassroot level, what is this? This involves, the grassroot involves local people, local communities. And what do? Whatever resources they have, they may be limited, you know, but they are going to make the maximum benefit out of, or maximum development out of the minimum resources. That is what this grassroot upward planning is. From the grassroot, it is, the benefit is just passed on and then it just spreads over to all other parts, that is to the higher levels. So that's about the grassroot upward planning. When you take this trickle down, see, like just how the water trickles down here, the wealthy, the rich, the wealth from the rich is just passed on. For example, you take a man who has set up a huge business and is doing a lot of employment he's giving to a lot of people. So thereby he is uplifting the livelihood of so many people. That is his work, right? Now that is the trickle down. The wealth is just passed on to everyone else. But what we believe in sustainable development is this grassroot upward planning will be much better than the trickle down theory. Okay, now coming to the next part, it is the natural resource accounting. Usually what happens in countries, whenever a big project is set up, what they do is they would only take the profit and the loss. You have learnt about profit and loss, no? So they will say this is the cost that is involved and this is the profit that we would get in a project. So that is how it usually goes. The accounting usually goes that way. But in the process, they have always missed out the cost of the natural resources, or the loss or the deprivation of environment, or the degradation of the environment. Say you cut down a lot of trees, then what happens? There is soil erosion, there is degradation of the soil. So there is a degradation or a decline in the environment. That also has to be taken into account. That is what this natural resource accounting is about. Okay, and it was started by the UN because many countries came up with a lot of projects not taking this into account. This is a huge thing that we cannot ignore, okay? And this gross domestic product had to be changed slightly. Why it has to be changed? Because again, we have to take the loss due to these projects. What happens to the environment? the loss of the environment, the loss of resources. A lot of water may be used in a project, or a lot of wood may be used in a project. That loss also has to be taken into consideration. So when you consider that also, you have to subtract that from the GDP so that you get the environmentally adjusted GDP. This is what this natural resource accounting is about. And actually, for an example, if I give you, supposing there's a carpenter who is making some furniture out of the wood, and he happens to cut down a tree to make, say, two chairs and two tables. The cost of that tree, let us take it as 100 rupees. It's much more, maybe 1000 rupees, let's take it. Now, this 1000 rupees is lost, which is not coming into the account. But the profit that he gets out of these two tables and two chairs are already there. So what the UN suggests is that, United Nations suggests that, we have to take that also into account and subtract that, then only the real profit comes. Okay, that's what this natural resource accounting is about. So we learned about EIA, and then we learned about this grassroot upward planning, and then the last, natural resource accounting. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have enjoyed this, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Bye-bye.